making all that money. Yeah, the money that they spent. Take another look now and take some time for him. I don't cut trees for paper, cause it hurts the environment. Stop deforestation, yeah, it's time for him. Oh, an acre of hemp makes 20 barrels of oil. No need for pesticides to poison all our soil. People got no food, they got no clothes, they got no rent. Well, right now it's time for hemp.
All right.
Thank you for taking time for hemp. I'm your host, Casper Leach. You are listening to the live broadcast of Time for Hemp all around the world at timeforhemp.com, iHeartRadio, Tumblr, SoundCloud, iTunes, and every place on the internet where people like to get together and share knowledge about how important it is to end prohibition. Every Monday on the big broadcast is Healthy Mondays with our joint guests here, Mary Lynn Mathery and Al Byrne from Patients at a Time. I want to give you a reminder that the Time for Hemp radio show is now the Time for Hemp Global Broadcasting Network. We now are broadcasting nearly around the clock with 20 hosts giving you 35 hours of new content each week to enjoy and share with your friends. And we're going to keep growing and growing and growing. Like I said, it is Healthy Mondays. A big shout out to Head Shop Canada and to KDK Distributors for giving us a grant to keep us loud, proud, and strong. And let's get focused on the healthy body and the healthy mind that's created by using the medical marijuana plant in such a healthy way with our joint hosts, Mary Lynn Mathery and Al Byrnes, and one of their joint friends is someone I am lucky enough to have met once and have always enjoyed his work, his writings, and anytime he's on TV, I make it a point to watch him, Dr. Andrew Weil. Mary Lynn and Al, I'll let you do the proper introductions. Dr. Andrew Weil, it's quite an honor to have you on my big broadcast.
Thank you.
Well, I agree with you, Casper, and I thank you very much, Andy, for coming on board. I can't imagine that there's any one of our 2.5 million listeners out there that doesn't know the name, but Dr. Weil is a very well-known, prolific author of many books. Just a few of them here, From Chocolate to Morphine, The Natural Mind, Spontaneous Healing, Spontaneous Happiness. I'm going to say that Dr. Weil, I hope I use the right term here, Andy, but you are the founder of the University of Arizona's Center for Integrative Medicine.
That's correct.
I'm glad I did that right. And integrative medicine, I think that would be a way to start here. A lot of our listeners might not know what that means. Could tell us all.
Well, first of all, it's the way of the future. I think the short definition is that it's the intelligent combination of conventional and alternative medicine, but really it's much more than that. It's a new system of medicine that focuses on the body's innate capacity for healing, that looks at patients as more than just physical bodies, that considers all aspects of lifestyle and understanding health and illness, that places great emphasis on the practitioner-patient relationship, and uses all available therapies to manage disease and promote health as long as they don't cause harm.
Why not more integrative medicine centers in more medical centers around the country?
Well, it's coming. There's a group called the Consortium of Academic Health Centers for Integrative Medicine, and more than a third of the nation's medical schools have joined that. There are many textbooks of integrative medicine. There are courses in integrative medicine taught at many schools. Our center has graduated over 1,000 physicians from intensive fellowship training, and they're in practice in almost all states now. We operate an integrative medicine clinic in Phoenix. We have a very robust research department. I mean, it is coming, and it's coming not just because of patient demand, but because of economic necessity. As you know, our healthcare system is in tatters, and it's going to get worse. And integrative medicine really offers the promise of reducing healthcare costs by shifting the emphasis to health promotion and prevention, And by bringing into the mainstream treatments that aren't dependent on expensive technology, including pharmaceutical drugs.
Well, that's quite a growth. I really didn't know. You must be very proud of that accomplishment, Doctor. I would be. When we, of course, you know, we've only got a few minutes here with you today, but how do we integrate cannabis into our medical system, our medical program? I've been told that there are 157 medical schools in the United States. Our next conference will feature a doctor, part of the faculty, to study on all this. And what he found was that there was no cannabis courses or courses on the endocannabinoid system in any medical school. I would assume medicine like that.
It's part of a larger problem that there is really no teaching on botanicals and natural products. That's something we're trying to remedy. In our training programs, we have a very strong curriculum in botanical medicine, and we include information on medical marijuana. So, you know, we are trying to reach physicians and allied health professionals with that. That's gradually coming, but it's part of a long-standing neglect of this area in conventional medicine.
Yeah, I would think the public probably is a big push, too, for botanicals. More and more people seem to recognize that, you know, natural medicine is helpful. I think more and more some of the people seeing that just some of the long-term, the damage caused by some of the pharmaceuticals with short-term use or long-term use.
Yeah, it's tremendous. There's something like 400,000 deaths a year just in the hospitalized patient population in this country directly due to adverse reactions to prescribed drugs. And these are not mistakes. These are the right drugs given to the right patients for the right conditions, and 400,000 people die each year. The deaths that are caused by botanicals, you know, are a handful and usually result from mislabeling of something. And yet the press, both the medical press and popular press, are filled with articles about the dangers of herbal medicine. You know, the general message out there is that herbal medicine is dangerous because it's unregulated, whereas the products of pharmaceutical laboratories are safe, and it's just the other way around.
Yeah, boy.
And with cannabis, you know, cannabis is probably one of the safest of all therapeutic agents. You can't establish a lethal dose for it. You know, it has an enormous safety range that's unmatched by really anything that we use in pharmaceutical medicine.
Well, that is true. And one of the things that my personal physician made it a point to prescribe to me for one of my ailments was medical marijuana. He was in his 70s, and I was in Indiana, and he made it clear he could lose his license by doing so. Now, how does the medical community review medical marijuana now coast to coast? Are you still considered one of those on the fringe medical doctors who's reaching out for alternative ways to heal the body, or are they starting to recognize the many, many medicinal values in this plant and are starting to rally around it?
I think it's slow to come within the medical profession. I think this has been a patient-driven, consumer-driven movement. There's a need for much more education. Also, there's a problem in that from the point of view of medical doctors, medical cannabis use is not cleanly distinguished from recreational use, and that makes them uncomfortable. And I think for medical use, we need to have preparations that look like medical drugs. So, for example, this product that's sold in the UK and many other countries called Sativex, that's a whole cannabis extract that you spray under the tongue. And I've seen some products like this sold in dispensaries in Colorado, for example. This looks more like a medical preparation that doctors would be more comfortable using. You know, most doctors are not going to feel comfortable recommending that patients smoke something as a therapeutic agent.
Well, yeah, we can get on that. And of course, smoking is a sort of a red herring now. We have vaporization and topicals and edibles,
right.
Spray.
Yep. Yep.
And chewing gum. I mean, it's gone beyond the government's rhetoric, Doctor. But at the same time, we've also learned, especially in the last 4 or 5 years, about the CBD-rich cannabis
Yeah.
Which may mean that we could have a THC depleted cannabis, which would be less proactive. That seems attractive.
Yeah, well, all that's, very interesting. I would say also that clearly our society is on a path toward totally revisioning the cannabis plant and embracing it. I think we are moving toward total acceptance of it. I think it will be eventually legalized everywhere, both for recreational use and medical use. I hope we will begin also producing hemp fiber. I mean, we let all that production slip away to China for hemp food products. We let all that production slip away to Canada. You know, this is a plant that we should be embracing and cultivating for its many uses.
Well, you know, that's a key word. Every time I talk to the federal guys, they keep saying marijuana the drug. And I keep saying cannabis the plant. It's a plant. It's not a drug.
It's a plant. And it's a highly useful plant, probably one of the most useful of any plants. It's one that's been grown in many cultures for different purposes. And as I say, our prejudice, our cultural prejudice against it in recent times has really limited our ability to enjoy its benefits. And I think we're now seeing that change. So I'm quite confident that we're moving toward total acceptance of it and legalization of it.
What opened your eyes to this, Dr. Weil? I mean, so much propaganda against it. Being a physician, you actually probably put your license on the line by even opening your mouth about it way back when, you know, and you were very brave even 20 years ago to address it in your books.
Well, it's more than that. I, as a fourth-year medical student at Harvard Medical School in 1968, I did the first double-blind human experiments with marijuana, and that was published in Science magazine. So I'd say it's almost 45 years that I've been writing and saying what I believe are truthful things about cannabis. So
what
I
led
have a
you to that?
Of doing that.
What led you to that? What made you come to this plant first to begin to study it and then realize its value?
Well, I had been I was studying ethnobotany at Harvard, which is the study of plants of as used by native cultures and medicinal plants. And here was a plant that had tremendous uses in medicine of the past and also as a psychoactive plant. And I had tried it myself and found it very interesting. I knew many people were using it. This was in the mid-1960s. And it was just astonishing to me that so little was reliably known about it scientifically. So I wanted to study it and see what I could find out about it.
And you literally, you had college students, didn't you, come in and you could observe them while they used it and then did measurements?
Yeah, we did, very simple psychomotor tests. You know, one of the things that we showed, there was a widespread belief back then that marijuana dilated your pupils. We showed that it didn't. There was a widespread belief that it made you hungry because it affected blood sugar. We showed that it had no effect on blood sugar. Very simple stuff, but it didn't, and most importantly, we showed that you could study marijuana in a laboratory in human beings and get away with it. And there had been no human research with it. So, that was a real precedent to show that this was something you could, in fact, study.
What's been the most surprising fact about this plant to you?
Well, I think the discovery of the endocannabinoid system, the fact that we have receptors for these analogous compounds throughout our body, that they seem very key in regulating appetite and pleasure and immune function and are part of our defenses against cancer, and the possibility that, manipulating the system, may offer many medical possibilities. I'd say the most exciting frontier is looking at the possibility that cannabinoids may help prevent and treat many forms of cancer.
And nutritionally, doctor?
Well, I think, marijuana, cannabis is the source of an edible seed and an edible oil. That oil has a very healthy fatty acid profile. It's got, a fraction of omega-3 fatty acids that we need in our diets. The seed has a lot of fiber. You can make good foods out of hemp. I think hemp milk is very good. I much prefer it to rice milk. It's an alternative to soy milk. I think hemp seeds themselves are quite delicious if they're just dry toasted and flavored with something. So, you know, these are good, nutritious foods.
Doctor, I know we're getting close to, you've got to run off on us pretty quick here. I was wondering if you want to give out some information about maybe a URL or something about the center where people
live. Sure. My website is drweil.com. That's drweil.com. There's a wealth of information there about medical conditions, alternative treatments, integrative medicine, and about medical cannabis. And also, if you're interested in integrative medicine, the website of the Arizona Center for Integrative Medicine is azcim.org. And there's a lot of information there about our clinic, our training programs, conferences, and so forth.
Well, I want to thank you so much for being part of our big broadcast, and it has been quite an honor to have you on the show. I look forward to having you back on our program.
Great. I enjoyed it, and you're doing good work.
And
thank you very much for coming today.
Okay, bye, Mary Lynn. Bye, Al.
And take care, Eddie.
After this commercial break, we're going to come back with Mary Lynn and Al and Dr. Robert Melamed here on Time for Hemp.
No.
Physicians Clinic in the United States. THCF has offices all across the United States from Hawaii to Michigan. THCF Medical Clinics has helped approximately 150,000 patients obtain their medical marijuana permits to legally possess, grow, and use medical marijuana. If you have chronic pain, multiple sclerosis, or any other neurological degenerative disease, or if you have any gastrointestinal disorders such as GERD, irritable bowel syndrome, or if you have AIDS, cancer, spastic disorders, seizure disorders, or glaucoma, call us at 1-800-723-0188 or visit us online at hemp.org. Again, the number is 1-800-723-0188 and the site is hemp.org.
Excuse me for a moment while I vent about the mind-boggling stupidity of the autocratic, bureaucratic, right-wing, Neanderthal numbskulls who keep pushing an insane, inane, and inhumane holy war against marijuana, which is, after all, a weed. The most embarrassing thing for these holy warriors is that the weed is winning. They've been at this war since 1937, spending billions and billions of our tax dollars, militarizing our borders, and stomping on our Bill of Rights. They've used phone taps, garbage searches, jackbooted raids, and draconian prison terms to, well, to do what? To nab peaceful, mellow tokers who aren't bothering anyone, that's what. Despite 60 years of spending our money, they failed. 85% of Americans say marijuana is easy to obtain today. A third of our population says they've tried it. Nearly 15 million people partake of it at least monthly, and more high school students now smoke marijuana than cigarettes. Meanwhile, the holy warriors have become more fanatical and thuggish. A marijuana arrest is made every 41 seconds in America, 9 out of 10 of them for mere possession. In 2004, 772,000 Americans were arrested on marijuana charges, more than for all violent crimes combined. And 40,000 Americans are in prison today for this victimless crime, more than the entire prison populations of 8 European countries. Even sicker, the sanctimonious weed warriors have made it a crime for thousands of seriously sick people to get the medical benefits of using small amounts of doctor-prescribed marijuana. Weirdly, our doctors can prescribe cocaine for patients, but not marijuana. This is Jim Hightower saying, for information and action to stop this absurd war, call the Marijuana Policy Project, 202-462-5747.
Time for Hemp is an educational tool that can be found in iTunes, on Spreaker, and of course at timeforhemp.com. hemp.com.
Indigrow is your source for affordable induction grow lighting. First discovered in 1891 by Nikola Tesla, Indigrow lights deliver 11 years of electronic sunlight to your plants. Indigrow lamps require less than half the power of traditional HID lamps. Converting to Indigrow lights means you'll cut down on your power bill with less lighting. Indigrow lamps also use 5 times less mercury than traditional fluorescent or HID lamps, making Indigrow not only energy efficient, but environmentally friendly as well. No more switching out lamps between vegetative and flowering stages. As nature intended, your lights get a steady dose of UV light that makes your plants grow healthier and stronger. Indigrow products are manufactured in San Diego, California, and come with a written 10-year warranty. What Tesla knew, then growers know now, is that Indigrow lighting is the cost-effective addition to your victory garden. To learn more or order now, go to inda-grow.com. That's inda-grow.com. Or call 877-452-2244 to answer any of your questions. These guys really know lights. Indigrow really is your sunlight in a box.
Well, I once had a bow, good green reaver, big fat don't be much, much sweeter.
Yeah, baby, Fire Up right now. I want to thank you for tuning in today and being part of our big broadcast. It was amazing to have Dr. Andrew Weil on our show. We have Dr. Donald Abrams joining us in this break. And now that we've ended that break, and I want to thank everybody here from Patients at a Time for putting together a spectacular program. I want to remind people that Mary Lynn and Al do a program every Sunday here on the new network, the Time for Hemp Broadcasting Network, and you can find them at 10 a.m. every Sunday. And then, of course, they are also in iHeart, iTunes, Tumblr, SoundCloud, and everywhere else. Our audience wants to embrace the world and tell it to end prohibition and make medical marijuana available so that patients who need it are no longer criminals. I'm going to pass this program back over to Mary Lynn and Al for their joint discussion with Dr. Donald Abrams while I sit here and hush my mouth and learn here on Time for Hemp.
Well, today we're really glad to have Donald Abrams here, and he actually is, he comes from San Francisco area, but he's actually down in Tucson now teaching at the Integrative School of Medicine there. He's on their faculty, a graduate of Integrative Medicine and an oncologist. And I guess, Donald, what'd you say? You were just finishing lecturing this morning?
Yeah, this is the graduation week for the fellows who have done a 2-year online program in integrative medicine from Dr. Weil's program at the University of Arizona, and they have me for the last 4 or 5 years. I've been coming to lecture on marijuana, is it medicine yet? And this year when I was introduced, Tijuana Low Dog said it's particularly relevant this year with all of the changes we're seeing across the country with the number of states that have cannabis available for medical purposes, as well as Colorado and Washington now totally legalizing altogether.
Yeah, it's about time. Everybody's got to start paying attention to it now, and hopefully physicians will when patients come in and start asking them questions about it.
So what was your answer?
Yeah.
What was my answer?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, you know, I spoke for an hour and a half about cannabis as medicine, and, you know, it's... I'm still struck by how much misinformation physicians have. And it's not as much misinformation as total lack of information. I mean, we just don't learn about cannabis in routine medical education, either in medical school or in continuing medical education conferences that much. Certainly Patients Out of Time promotes it in our continuing medical education conferences that we do with UCSF, but in general, I mean, the fact that the cannabinoid receptor in the brain is the second most densely populated receptor in the human brain, and that we don't learn about it in medical school because of, you know, cannabis paranoia and the war on drugs is, I think, reprehensible.
Well, we agree.
We all agree with that. I know Dr. Weil agrees with that. I've heard him say in public at the conference in Tucson we had a couple of years ago that he thought that it was an abdication of medical responsibility to pass this kind of stuff off to cops and lawyers.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, there's nothing else to say. I mean, where is the medical profession on this? I mean, I know you're there, and Dr. Weil has, was just saying to us that I think he says now he's graduated 1,000 physicians from his courses, and that's an impressive number, but aren't there something well over 1 million of you or something?
I don't even know. But, you know, the American Medical Association is at least saying the word and says essentially more research is necessary. What they don't appreciate is the difficulty of doing research of medicinal cannabis. You know, it's not an easy thing to do for those of us that have been doing it.
I would even think, though, Doctor, that, I mean, medical cannabis being what it is, we all find it fascinating and fascinated, and nobody is fascinated along with us. But what about the endocannabinoid system? I just can't understand why every physician in the world isn't going, wow.
Well, again, because they're not aware of it. So that's what we need to do, is increase the awareness of, you know, to physicians and patients about the existence of the endocannabinoid system and the cannabinoid receptors in the body. They're there for a reason, and a lot of that reason has to do, in my opinion, with pain. You know, these are very potent drugs in our armamentarium against pain, and so many people suffer from chronic pain disorders that it's just a shame that they don't, physicians and patients themselves aren't aware of the potential utility of cannabis.
Yeah, and I think, you know, I'd like you to speak to the issue of, you know, I talk a lot about when physicians make recommendations that the hope would be that you start with the least harmful medication, and if that doesn't work, you go to stronger and stronger medications. And unfortunately, for, like you say, a lot of people, and especially with neuropathic pain, things aren't working, and it just seems then they start, okay, well, let's look at some opioids and keep going stronger and stronger.
Right. That is a shame because, you know, the evidence suggests that the opiates are not particularly effective in neuropathic pain, and so many people have neuropathic pain for long periods of time, diabetics, patients with HIV, people, you know, my patients with cancer, we can now cure people from cancer, but they suffer from persistent neuropathic pain. And a number of clinical trials have demonstrated that cannabis is useful in this situation. And in fact, the trials are very consistent in the so-called number needed to treat. That is, how many people do you need to expose to cannabis to get a response? And the number needed to treat for peripheral neuropathy is about 3.5, which means that, you know, 1 in 3 people or 1 in 4 people are going to get success from using cannabis to treat neuropathic pain, which is a big problem. And it's a much safer drug, as you mentioned, than opiates, which are totally addictive. And actually, because of the preponderance of opiate receptors on the brainstem, much easier to overdose and die on than cannabis.
Are you able to do that, Donald, in California, in your practice? Are you able to, if you got a brand new patient, hadn't been on anything at all, are you able to say to him or her, let's go with cannabis first?
Well, you know, I treat mainly cancer patients, and I can certainly, in California, make a recommendation that a cancer patient consider using cannabis for many things. I mean, a day doesn't go by when I don't see a cancer patient who's suffering from loss of appetite, nausea and vomiting from either their cancer or their chemotherapy, pain, depression, insomnia. And for these people, I can recommend that they try one medicine instead of writing them prescriptions for 5 different drugs that all might interact with each other or with the chemotherapy I'm giving them. I can say, why don't you try cannabis? And, you know, patients that do seem to benefit, in my experience. You know, I haven't been studying that in any systematic way, but, gee, I see a lot of people who don't like the side effects of their anti-nausea medicines. Many people get constipated and just don't feel right, and they, you know, more and more people come in and say, well, gee, I stopped it because cannabis works great.
Yeah, boy.
Now, Andy Weil was just saying that one of the reasons he believes that modern medicine doctors, even of your age and peer group, won't accept cannabis as a medical agent is because it doesn't look like a medical agent that they used to.
Well, yeah, I mean, we're used to people swallowing a pill. And they did make, as you know, they make Delta-9 tetrahydrocannabinol, Delta-9 THC, the most psychoactive component of cannabis, is available as a pill, in a pill form, Delta-9 THC in sesame oil. So that's what doctors are comfortable with. But, you know, cannabis itself, the plant, has 400 other chemicals in it that are there to provide the balance to the Delta-9 THC, the main psychoactive component. So some of them boost the benefits of the THC, and some of them downplay some of the adverse effects. So
can I clear something up here, Donald? I mean, we've known each other a long time, and I don't know the answer to this, and I keep getting beat up by it every once in a while. I keep running into the argument that the reason we don't have a cannabis plant, whole extract pill, or something of that nature is because the FDA hasn't gone through the approval process for cannabis. But then I look around and I say, wait a minute, it's a plant. FDA doesn't have to approve eating vegetables. That's not their job. And on the other hand, back in 1930-something, bottles of cannabis medicine made by Eli Lilly and Merck and everybody else, and it says approved by the Food and Drug Act of 1930, whatever. What's going on? What's this FDA thing? We don't need that, do we?
Yeah, well, unfortunately, you missed a few steps there. Yeah, so in 1937, the Marijuana Tax Act imposed a levy of $1 an ounce for medicinal use and $100 an ounce for recreational use for people that were using cannabis as medicine or recreationally. And this was imposed by Harry Anslinger, who was a prohibitionist and a racist, who was concerned that widespread use of cannabis by African-American jazz musicians and Mexican migrant workers was going to lead to increased crime and mental illness in the United States, both of which were pure hysteria. But this led to the removal of cannabis from the U.S. pharmacopoeia, or the formulary of available drugs, in 1942. Cannabis has probably been used as a medicine for 3,000 years. It hasn't been a medicine in this country only for 72 years. In 1970, it got put in Schedule 1, which means that it's a substance that has no accepted medical use and a high potential for abuse. And Schedule 1 substances are only prescribable with a special license from the government that you have to apply for. So the FDA definitely and the Drug Enforcement Administration need to be involved in any studies of cannabis. The only legal source of cannabis to do research on in the country is NIDA, the National Institute on Drug Abuse. And NIDA has a mandate from Congress that they can only fund studies that are looking at the adverse effects of cannabis and not as the therapeutic benefits. So unfortunately, your thoughts are well-founded, but a little bit naive, I fear to say. Anytime you're trying to develop something as a potential therapeutic agent in a clinical trial, the FDA does need to be involved.
What about Centrum Silver? That never went through the FDA, and we got people all over America swallowing thousands of those pills.
So these are nutritional supplements, and the DSHEA Act introduced in Congress protects nutritional supplements, fortunately or unfortunately, depending on your perspective, from being evaluated and approved by the FDA.
So
many people think that we'd have much higher quality supplements if there was some sort of regulatory body that was looking to see what's in the supplements that people take.
Yeah, but there isn't. So if I eat cannabis as food, what's the problem? What's the government's problem with that?
The plant is illegal.
The plant is illegal, but I mean,
right.
Yeah, I mean, this. I guess what I'm saying is, Doctor, I mean, this whole premise that the government has built its case on is faulty, and if the premise of any mathematical computation is wrong, the end result's wrong. We've got something here that has no medical value. The world knows that's BS. I mean, with all that being such contrary to logic and rationale and actual science, what's holding back our medical professionals in government from accepting the leadership of the head of the Veterans Health Administration, who is an MD, who's declared cannabis as a medicine?
I missed that. Who's that?
His name is Dr. Petzl.
Robert
Petzl. Dr. Petzl 2010, actually, July 2010, wrote a directive, which has been amended now. It's January of 2011, but it says the same thing. It says that veterans who live in states or the District of Columbia where the citizens or the legislature have made cannabis medicine available can use, with the proper state paperwork, cannabis in their medical therapeutic program and be treated in Veterans Health Administration hospitals and facilities, just like any other patient. He said that it is medicine, that it should be treated as a medicine, and it shall be not a problem. However, just for detail, it is a problem. The fact that there's only 21 states means that there's 39 states where 29 states where veterans cannot use cannabis as a medicine and be treated in the Veterans Health Administration facilities. That includes me when I live in Florida and Virginia. If I go in and say I use medicine, cannabis as a medicine, they escort me off the grounds and tell me to come back in 30 days when I'm clean. But the point is, Dr. Petzl, I believe that there should be a monument to this fellow. He's a medical doctor who stands for medicine and the treatment of veterans. And the other thing I liked about him, when he sent me and Mike Kravitz a letter, every time the word veteran was used in his letter, he capitalized it. We need more doctors like that.
Yeah, I think what we liked about that was he's stuck. The VA docs are federal employees, so that's why it had to be the legal states where a legal doc does. But as Al said, you know, the VA doctors are to treat cannabis as medicine if they have a recommendation from a civilian doctor. But the other problem they get is, because it's federal property, the patients can't bring that medicine. Then if they go in the hospital, they can't have it in the hospital with them.
So exactly. That's my understanding of our Veterans Administration Hospital in California. Although I've lectured there on the topic, my understanding is that it's still pretty taboo because it's a federal property.
That's right, exactly. Right. So we've got this, this conundrum. Really, it's a conundrum for the government, I believe. I don't believe that folks like you, medical professionals that have been working with cannabis for all these years, have a doubt in your mind that it has therapeutic value. And I think there's millions of patients that agree with you. And I guess what I'm trying to do, and Patients at a Time is trying to do, is just call people's attention to the illogic and see if we can't get somebody in government to say, you know, this is just flat wrong. Maybe the president. Somebody that could, like the president, who could just say,
Al, it sounds like you took a naive pill today. I don't want to say anything, you know.
No, it's not a naive pill. I see the president of the United States wearing another hat, a hat that I had sworn allegiance to. The same one. He's the commander in chief.
Right.
Commander in chief. And he has troops in the field that are being treated right, and he has troops in the field that aren't being treated right. That's flat out the way it is. That's not naive. That's the way it is.
Okay.
And he is the commanding general of our forces, and he could change that with an order. That is what I call leadership. That is what Dr. Petzl did. He issued an order, and it changed things. That can be done in this country by people that actually have some huevos on them. And our president, as a commander-in-chief, should be as strong a man as you are and do what's right.
Well, I've got to do what's right, and I'm going to place an order right now that we go to a commercial break, and I'm going to order all my audience members to tell all of my sponsors that you heard about them here on Time for Hemp.
Well now, chocolate cake makes my poor stomach ache, and all those pills are too much for me to take. I don't like cocaine cause it makes me all uptight, but coffee and reefer makes me feel all right. Crystal meth will make you high.
If you are in the Portland, Oregon area and are an OMMP cardholder, then come down to Nikki's Diggity Dank Market. Portland, Oregon's first and only weekly OMMP market. Presented by the Alternative Wellness Center, located at 5241 Southeast 72nd Avenue, two blocks south of Foster Boulevard, close to public transportation, held every Sunday 10 a.m. till 7 p.m. Connecting quality vendors with patients. Nikki's Diggity Dank Market also has a weekly raffle with products from every vendor. So come down to Nikki's Diggity Dank Market and have fun while connecting with quality vendors and getting great natural medicine. If you are a vendor and want a chance to connect with OMMP patients, you can check out their Facebook page at facebook.com/alternativewellnesscenter or call 971-888-4392. Be sure to register early because space is limited. Nikki's Diggity Dank Market.
My name is Angel Rach. I'm a mother of two teenage children, and I fought all the way to the Supreme Court for the right to use the medicine that saved my life. I've been permanently disabled for 10 years, with an inoperable brain tumor, wasting syndrome, and several other serious conditions. For 4 years, I was in a wheelchair, in so much pain, I couldn't even hug my kids. The hardest part was looking in their eyes and seeing how much they were suffering because of my medical condition. The medicine that gave me my life back and gave my kids their mom back was cannabis, also known as medical marijuana. With medical marijuana, I can walk, maintain my weight, and I can be a mom. Without it, my doctors believe that I would die. To learn more about medical marijuana, contact Marijuana Policy Project at 1-877-JOIN-MPP or on the web at mpp.org.
Sirius Seeds is your source for quality cannabis and sativa seeds. Sirius Seeds are the creators of legendary strains like AK-47, Bubblegum, Karate, Cali Mist, and White Russian. The AK-47 is probably the most awarded strain on the planet. The high THC content of AK-47 makes it the perfect medical strain for patients seeking quick pain relief. Cali Mist is an almost pure sativa. Female medical cannabis patients have reported that this strain helps relieve menstrual cramps. Sirius Seeds just acquired another Dutch high-quality seed bank, Magus Genetics. From now on, Sirius Seeds can offer you even more award-winning strains. The fine folks at Sirius Seeds strive to breed the best cannabis genetics that they can find, so patients can rely on the effectiveness of their medicine. Go to SiriusSeeds.com to grow your medicine. That site again is SiriusSeeds.com.
Now, when it comes to medical marijuana, I have more of a practical view than anything else. I mean, my attitude is that if it's an issue of doctors prescribing medical marijuana as a treatment for glaucoma or as a cancer treatment, I think that should be appropriate because there really is no difference between that and a doctor prescribing morphine or anything else. I think there are legitimate concerns in not wanting to allow people to grow their own or start setting up mom and pop shops, because at that point it becomes fairly difficult to regulate. And you know, again, I'm not familiar with all the details of the initiative that was passed and what safeguards there were in place, but I think the basic concept that using medical marijuana in the same way with the same controls as other drugs prescribed by doctors, I think that's entirely appropriate.
This may sound strange, but I want to pay taxes. See, I don't drink alcohol or smoke cigarettes. I relax with something science has proven is much safer, marijuana. And I want to buy it somewhere that charges taxes to pay for schools and roads, just like alcohol and tobacco. What do you think should profit? Are schools and roads or drug dealers?
Visit the Marijuana Policy Project Foundation at joinmpp.org or call 1-877-JOIN-MPP.
Education and information. See what all the buzz is all about. It's time for hemp. It's time for hemp.
Mother Nature gave us a gift sublime. Soothe and protect our body and mind. But politics made it a dichotomy. And the karma of the farmer is the bottom line. I want my medicine between God and me. I can grow it from a little seed. Where pills don't cure my ills, and heaven's not a crime. I'm a patient out of town. Colorado's all about CBD. I just want a plan to fill my need, 'cause I'm still a patient out of time. I want my medicine between God and me. I can grow it from a little seed. Where pills don't cure my ills, and healing's not a crime. Out of time. Well, pills don't cure my ills, healing's not a crime. I'm still a patient out of time.
Don't let the music confuse you. You are listening to the Time for Hemp broadcast on the Time for Hemp Broadcasting Network. And yes, for those of you who are fans of Mary Lynn Mathery and Al Burns from Patience at a Time, that is the theme song to their brand new show on the Time for Hemp Broadcasting Network, found every Sunday morning, 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. And make it a point to tune in and tell your friends how wonderful they are. And they're nice enough to be the joint host on the big broadcast today. And we want to thank their joint guest and a joint friend of ours, Dr. Donald Abrams, for being on the show today, too. And it would behoove me to hush my mouth and let genius speak. So I will let our joint guest have the floor. And Mary Lynn and Al, I want to thank you for bringing such wonderful guests to our big broadcast today.
Well, thank you for being giving us the opportunity to do all this. It's I hope our listeners learn every from every show, because we talk to all kinds of people on Mondays like this. We talk to cannabis experts, and on the Sunday show, as Casper talked about, we try to talk to patients and their caregivers, and that includes family members, because we are a patient-driven organization. We believe that the patient's stories need to be heard, that they're telling the truth. There are millions of them. And Dr. Abrams has treated any number of patients. And, Doctor, I know our listeners are wanting to know as much as they can, because everybody in the world wants to know as much as they can about the combination or the connection between cannabis and cancer. Can you connect some dots there?
Okay, good. Well, I think that there's increasing evidence that some of the compounds in cannabis may have activity actually against cancer. Cannabis in and of itself is anti-inflammatory, or decreases inflammation. It's also an antioxidant, taking out of circulation free radicals of oxygen, which can also lead to DNA damage that causes cancer. So those are two mechanisms by which cannabis may decrease a risk of cancer. And then as scientists look in more detail, there are other biochemical interactions that the active ingredients in cannabis have with cancer cells and with cells in general that seem to suggest that they may increase programmed cell death, something that disappears, if you will, in cancer cells, They may decrease the formation of new blood vessels, which allow cancer cells to spread through the body, and they may also decrease some of the enzymes that allow cancer cells to be invasive. So all of this is really exciting information, but it's mostly demonstrated in test tubes and increasingly in some animal models. Evidence that cannabis really protects or prevents against cancer in humans is a little harder to come by, because after all, the gold standard of these sorts of experiments are randomized placebo-controlled clinical trials, and nobody's going to randomize 50,000 people over here to smoke cannabis and 50,000 people over there not to smoke cannabis for the next 20 years and see what happens with cancer.
Yeah.
I think one of the more interesting findings, my friend and colleague Manuel Guzman, who's in Madrid, is a PhD, and he had a laboratory that was interested in studying the effects of cannabinoids on metabolism of cells. The most highly metabolic cells in the body are the brain cells. So his team of investigators made cultures of human brain cells and added cannabis to see what the effect was on their energy metabolism. And they decided, well, maybe we could do more research quicker if we use brain cancer cells or brain tumors, because they're metabolizing even quicker. So they took a culture of brain cancer cells, glioblastoma, and they put their cannabis on the cells, and they died. So they said, oh, we must have done something wrong. So they repeated the experiment, and those cells died again. So they went back to their normal brain cells that they've been using for years, and the cells lived. So this sort of suggested that cannabinoids may have activity against brain tumor cells, and makes a little bit of sense, because the cannabinoid receptor is the second most densely populated receptor in the human brain. So adding, you know, things that complex with that receptor may actually have some impact on brain tumors. So the research has extended beyond that by taking human cancers and transplanting them into mice that don't have an immune system. And in that setting, if you give those mice cannabinoids, the active ingredients in cannabis, a number of different cancers seem to be suppressed: lung, thyroid, lymphoma, brain, skin. So, you know, this is all very intriguing evidence, but as I mentioned, the evidence that that cannabis works as an anti-cancer agent in humans is at this point lacking. And what we see instead are people extrapolating from information in the test tubes and jumping way ahead into saying that it has effects in humans. Let me give you a concrete example. One of my colleagues in San Francisco, Sean McAllister, has a group of triple-negative breast cancer cells that he grows in culture. Triple-negative breast cancer means it doesn't have receptors for estrogen, progesterone, or the HER2-NU, all of which can be attacked with specific hormones or antibodies. So triple-negative breast cancer is the most aggressive type. And he finds that triple-negative breast cancer has increased expression of a gene called ID1. And when he adds CBD or cannabidiol to cultures of these triple-negative breast cancer cells, that down-regulates or decreases the production of the ID1 product. So when that paper got published in the newspapers, the report said cannabis cures triple-negative breast cancer. Well, that's a big leap. Cannabis in a cell culture decreased production of a gene product that's present in triple-negative breast cancer, but we haven't done any experiments where we've given women with triple-negative breast cancer CBD to say that it can cure them. So that's what I mean by a big leap from the test tube information into, you know, human experience, and we need to do those studies, certainly, but I think evidence or suggestions that cannabis cures cancer are premature at this time.
Okay. Donald, thank you so much for this. Before we have to go here, Could you tell us about Clint Werner's book? There's a lot of great information in there for folks.
Yeah, so Clint Werner, who is my spouse, wrote a book called Marijuana Gateway to Health, How Cannabis Protects Us Against Cancer and Alzheimer's. And he's working on a second edition where he may change the title, How Cannabis Protects Us Against Cancer, Alzheimer's, and Diabetes, because there is some increasing evidence that cannabis may decrease the risk of diabetes. It's a great book, and it talks all about the endocannabinoid system and cannabinoid receptors, as we were discussing earlier. Right. It's very easily accessible to the lay reader and has changed a lot of people's minds about the medicinal benefits of cannabis.
It sure has. Dr. Abrams, thank you so much for coming on the show, sir. Thank you for your time and your expertise.
It's a pleasure. Take care. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Okay, bye-bye.
Quite a fantastic program, I can certainly tell you that. And Dr. Abrams, I want to thank you, too, for being on our show.
Okay, my pleasure. It seemed to that the last half sort of went very quickly there.
It did, and people always say that when they're on the show because we do enjoy getting so much information out to our audience, and there really isn't as much time as we would like. And did you get a chance to give a shout-out to your URL one more time?
Well, we got the book out. That was where the main focus we wanted, Casper.
Make sure people know how to buy it and get it. And
Marijuana Gateway to Health, it's on Amazon.
Beautiful. All right. And Marilyn, now there's ability to get university credit from going to your website. We haven't mentioned that since the new year. Why don't you let people know about that now, because they're going to be planning their courses this next couple of weeks for their next semester.
That's right. If you or your doctor, your healthcare professional, goes to www.medicalcannabis.com, you will see a direct link over to the University of California School of Medicine, where Dr. Abrams is a professor, and those links will take that professional to a couple of courses on cannabis, where they will receive CMEs, which are accreditation for their continuing education work. It's easy, it's online, it's available. You're a doctor, you're a nurse, and if you're a patient, you should catch it and catch them to have it, have them look at it, or they're not really treating you well.
Or get them to go May 8th through 10th, the 8th National Clinical Conference on Cannabis Therapeutics will be in Portland, Oregon.
Dr. Abrams will be on the faculty, and we will have Dr. Abrams on later in the months here before the conference starts to discuss his presentation at that May conference. So we'll get Dr. Abrams back again, and until then, again, thank you, Doctor, and thank you, Casper.
And to make this program even more special, we're going to end it just a little differently. We're going to close the program out with a song called Herbal Healing by Ross David, and then we're going to let it wrap up with our normal Time for Hemp theme song here on the big program. And tomorrow's Canadian Day, so let all your friends know that we're going to be putting a spotlight on the hardworking Canadian activists here on Time for Hemp.
Herbal healing, herbal healing. It's Nayaman singing his song. You better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb, we heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. It's Nayaman singing his song. You better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb, we heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. What I see and I observe, no chemical, it is a natural herb. Go spread the word, it calm your nerve and soothe your mind when you feel disturbed. With my conga drum singing my song, you better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb, we heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. You hypocrite and parasite, why you a fight against the tree of life? You don't hear how much people are living a pain, and it make them sleep at night. With my conga drum singing my song, you better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb, we heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. This conga drum singing my song, you better listen to the medicine man.
Legalize the herb and heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon, Solomon. Give all your vote. While millions are dead when they inhale the smoke, you take away their passport. This Nayaman singing his song. You better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb and heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. This Nayaman singing his song. You better listen to the Rasta man. Legalize the herb and heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. This is a spiritual and herbal war. Won't make you no lock down your friend Ron Barn. Gonna kill more people by far. So divine intervention I am calling for. When my phone go drum, chanting this song. You better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb, we heal the nation. Found on the grave of King Solomon. This congo drum, singing my song. You better listen to the medicine man. Legalize the herb, we heal the nation. Found on the tomb of King Solomon, Solomon.
Just give me a second, let me take a dry, you know.
Work herb. It makes me unwind. So don't you run around my herb.
got three for